Good morning. Welcome to our service this morning. A very warm welcome to our members and an extra special welcome to those of you listening in or watching for the first time. We hope that you enjoy the service today and that you'll experience something of God, that you'll feel His closeness and His presence as He wraps you up in His arms of love, as we praise Him, as we worship Him, and as we read from His scriptures. Ndiya nibulisa. Nonkengengama, lenkosi yetu u Jesu Christu. Ek groet julle elkeen in die naam van ons Here Jesus Christus. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Last week we had a whole list of people who celebrated their birthday, and this week it's one of those rare occasions where there's no one on our membership list. But if it is your birthday and we've missed it, or if you are celebrating your birthday and we are unaware of it, happy, happy birthday. We hope that you have an awesome day where you spoilt absolutely rotten. And may you have a year that is blessed, where God will make His face to shine upon you, where He will keep you close, and where He will protect you. We're going to start this morning by listening to a hymn of praise that reminds us that we are loved, that we are accepted by God. Let's listen to the hymn, Blessed Assurance. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 91, verse 14 to 16, and here it reads as follows. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. And here ends the reading. Our Lord and our God is truly, truly amazing. He makes it clear to us time and time again in the Bible, in the scriptures, that He will be with us. If we go through pain, if we go through suffering, if we go through times of trouble, He's right there with us, carrying us, protecting us, and loving us through every second. So at the start of this service, let's come to God. Let's share with Him what's going on in our minds and our hearts. Let's give our beings over to Him as we focus our mind and our attention on Him. Let's start with a silent individual prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, You see us. You see us for who we are, for who we want to be, for who You created us to be. You see our problems, our fears, our worries, our troubles. You see our excitement, our joy, our blessings we receive. You see the relationships we struggle in. You see the good and the bad that happens to us. You see the good and the bad that we do. You see us, our hearts, our beings. And this is too magnificent for us to even think about or even begin to understand. Everything we do, everything we think, everything we experience, You know. Thank You, Lord, that You are there with us through it all, through all the mountaintops, through all the valleys, through all the suffering, through all the pain, through all the heartache, through all the trouble, through all the abuse and manipulation, through all the joy and all the happiness, through all the good times, through all the laughter, through everything. Thank You that You remain steadfast, You remain faithful, and You remain constant in our lives. Lord, as You see us and You watch us, You also know and notice the things that we do that are wrong. You see those times we oppress and abuse, those times we hate and judge, those times we swear and lie, those times our own ego becomes inflated, those times where pride gets the better of us, those times greed is all we have, those times we react in an unloving way because we are hurt. Those times we boast about things we don't really need to boast about. Those times we just let You down and we continue in our sinful ways. Lord, please take a moment to hear us as we bring to You our silent and individual confessions. God, have mercy. Lord, forgive us, for we have sinned. Let Your grace flow over us as You cleanse us. Lord, You know the reasons we do what we do, but there's no excuse. We know that, Lord. So please take us as we are. Forgive us and restore us. Thank You, Lord, that we know when we truly repent, when we truly turn to You, when we truly intend on not committing these sins again, You come and forgive. You come and take our sins and toss it into the deepest oceans, never to think of it again. As we page through the Bible, we know that You continue to love the sinner and hate the sin. Thank you for this grace. Thank you for this comfort. Thank you for this love. Thank you that we are your children and you are our God now and in ages past. Thank you that we can come to you, that we know you hear, that we know you understand, that we know you always have compassion. Thank you for who you are and that we can worship you. We ask that as we come to read the scriptures, as we come to hear the hymns, Lord, wrap us in your arms. Holy Spirit, come and move in us and through us and around us so that we can feel your presence closer than our very own heartbeat. Connect with us today, Lord. We ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're now going to listen to the hymn, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. Reading this morning comes from Judges 19, and we're going to be reading the whole chapter. So you're more than welcome to take your Bible and to read along with me. I'll be reading from the NIV translation. So are you ready? Let's begin. In those days, Israel had no king. Now a Levite who lived in a remote area in the hill country of Ephraim took a concubine from Bethlehem in Judah, but she was unfaithful to him. She left him and went back to her father's house in Bethlehem, Judah. After she had been there 4 months, her husband went to her to persuade her to return. He had with him his servant and 2 donkeys. She took him into her father's house, and when her father saw him, he gladly welcomed him. His father-in-law, the girl's father, prevailed upon him to stay, so he remained with him 3 days, eating and drinking and sleeping there. On the 4th day, they got up early, and he prepared to leave. But the girl's father said to his son-in-law, "Refresh yourself with something to eat, and then you can go." So the two of them sat down to eat and to drink together. Afterward, the girl's father said, "Please stay tonight and enjoy yourself." And when the man got up to go, his father-in-law persuaded him, so he stayed there that night. On the morning of the 5th day, when he rose to go, the girl's father said, "Refresh yourself, wait till afternoon." So the two of them ate together. Then the man, with his concubine and his servant, got up to leave. His father-in-law, the girl's father, said, "Now look, it's almost evening. Spend the night here. The day is nearly over. Stay and enjoy yourself. Early tomorrow morning, you can get up and be on your way home." But, unwilling to stay another night, the man left and went toward Jebus with the two saddled donkeys and his concubine. When they were near Jebus and the day was almost gone, the servant said to his master, "Come, let's stop at the city of the Jebusites and spend the night." His master replied, "No, we won't go into an alien city whose people are not Israelites. We will go on to Gibeah." He added, "Come, let's try reach Gibeah or Ramah and spend the night in one of those places." So they went on, and the sun set as they neared Gibeah in Benjamin. There they stopped to spend the night. They went and sat in the city square, but no one took them into his home for the night. That evening, an old man from the hill country of Ephraim who was living in Gibeah, the men of the place were Benjamites, came in from the work in the fields. When he looked and saw the traveler in the city square, the old man asked, "Where are you going? Where did you come from?" He answered, "We are on our way from Bethlehem in Judah to a remote area in the hill country of Ephraim where I live. I have been to Bethlehem in Judah, and now I am going to the house of the Lord. No one has taken me into his house. We have both straw and fodder for our donkeys and bread and wine for ourselves, your servants, me, your maidservant, and the young man with us. We don't need anything." "You are welcome at my house," the old man said. "Let me supply whatever you need. Only don't spend the night in the square." So he took him into the house and fed his donkeys. After they had washed their feet, they had something to eat and drink. While they were enjoying themselves, some of the wicked men of the city surrounded the house. Pounding on the door, they shouted to the old man who owned the house, "Bring out the man who came to your house so that we can have sex with him." The owner of the house went outside and said to him, "No, my friends, don't be so vile. Since this man is my guest, don't do this disgraceful thing. Look, here's my virgin daughter and his concubine. I will bring them out to you now, and you can use them and do to them whatever you wish. But to this man, don't do such a disgraceful thing." But the men wouldn't listen. So the man took his concubine and sent her outside to them, and they raped her and abused her throughout the night. And at dawn, they let her go. At daybreak, the woman went back to the house where her master was staying, fell down at the door, and lay there until daylight. When her master got up in the morning and opened the door of the house and stepped out to continue in his way, there lay his concubine, fallen in the doorway of the house with her hands on the threshold. He said to her, "Get up, let's go." But there was no answer. Then the man put on his donkey and set out for home. When he reached home, he took a knife and cut up his concubine limb by limb into 12 parts and sent them into all the areas of Israel. Everyone who saw it said, "Such a thing has never been seen or done, not since the day the Israelites came up out of Egypt." Think about it. Consider it. Tell us what to do. Here ends our reading this morning. May the Lord bless to us the understanding of his holy word. Amen. Many of you will be aware of the fact that there's little Kitty that lives in this house, and very often when you listen to the devotions in the morning, you hear her purr in the background. This week, Olivia and I welcomed a new little furry friend into the house, a German Shepherd called Amber. Amber is 4 years old and she was rescued, and we adopted her from retreat to Eden. But Amber has a very sad background. In her very young 4 years, she's been severely abused, so severely abused that it still influences her life today. The way she thinks, the way she behaves, the way she reacts. Now, many of us are animal lovers, and we can't even imagine hurting or abusing an animal. Some of us don't necessarily like animals, but we're not going to do anything to hurt or abuse them either. But then there are still others that really couldn't care. They feel that animals are there for them to do what they want to do with. Now, there are many of us that will do anything in our power to protect an animal. But there are also those of us who won't. Violence and abuse, however, is not only found between humans and animals, but also amongst us as humans. If we keep an eye on the news, or we just listened to Cyril Ramaphosa's speech the other evening, we would become aware of how gender-based violence is at an alarming increase at this very moment in our country. Women and children are beaten, they're mistreated, they're abused, and they're even killed by the men in their lives that they were supposed to trust. Men who were supposed to protect them, be kind to them, and love them. Now, it will be silly of us to think that gender-based violence is only against women. There are women out there that also abuse their husbands, who get contract killers to kill their husbands. A very famous case in South Africa is the murder of Talib Peterson. There's also violence against people with a different sexual orientation, where they are raped or beaten to toughen them up or to fix them. Now, there are many men and women out there that do not abuse or hurt their partners and their friends. They are upright, they are trustworthy, they protect each other, they care about each other, they look after each other. But there are also those who don't. So what do we do with this violence? How are we supposed to understand it? Does the Bible even speak about things like this? The answer is yes. And our reading this morning shows us that the Bible isn't silent about these issues, especially not gender-based violence. Our reading this morning comes from the book of Judges. And the book of Judges actually plays off in an important time of Israel's history. And some actually call the book of Judges the book of chaos. It's a book of chaos because it was uncertain times where there wasn't really one leader that looked after the people. The people did that what was good in their own eyes. They turned away from God. Things would happen and God would then send a leader, someone like Gideon or Deborah or Samson, someone with upright integrity who'd unite the people, bring them back to God. God would forgive and things would go well. And then the leader would pass away. And before we know it, the people would start doing what is right in their own eyes again. They turn away from God. And then the whole process repeats again. But Judges is also a book filled with stories. Stories that were normally told to children around the campfire. And because it's stories told to children, explaining to them and informing them of the oral history before it was penned down. The stories normally have lots of wordplay in it, has very descriptive language, has lots of funny little tidbits to keep the children attentive. But it's also stories that showed the children one important thing, and that is that God is always in control, and that God will always provide. However, many of these stories in Judges are not only stories from a patriarchal society of the time, but it also tries to pave the way or make the case for a monarchy to be established, because many felt or thought that as soon as there's one leader, one servant of God that had integrity and was upright and looked over the people or governed the people, then this lawlessness and this chaos would end. And the rights of the poor, the rights of the strangers, the rights of the women and the widows and the children will be looked after, and they won't be vulnerable people in society. But as we page through the book, we also see subtle but very profound critical commentary on the dominant cultural practices of the time. The narrator gently guides the reader into a space where we can look at a situation and judge it or understand it ethically, morally, and theologically. And this is then especially true of our reading today, chapter 19. So let's have a closer look at chapter 19. Let's see how the narrator guides us and helps us to think about gender-based violence based on what he says, on how he says it, and most importantly, on what he doesn't say. Now in verse 1, we read, "In those days Israel had no king." This phrase is actually repeated 4 times in the book of Judges. It's in chapter 17 verse 6, chapter 18 verse 1, chapter 19 verse 1, and chapter 21 verse 2. And when we read these words, we can know that the story that we are about to read is not a happy story. The narrator uses this phrase to show the people, the readers, what can happen when there's a vacuum in the leadership. It leads to chaos, and it affirms this idea that the book of Judges is all about, that there has to be a monarchy. Now, when we read about the Levite who had a concubine, we need to remember that in the Old Testament, a concubine was considered to be a wife, a wife of secondary status, yes, but still a wife. So as we go through this chapter, I want you to critically assess the image you have of the Levite constantly. We are told in verse 3 that the woman was unfaithful to him. She left him and she went to her father's house in Bethlehem. Now the Hebrew word used here tells us that she left without permission. Unfaithful is a bit of an interesting translation. A better translation would have been she deserted him. Now we have to understand that in the patriarchal society of the Old Testament, a woman had very little rights. Her whole life was connected to a male figure. This male is the one that would give her status, would give her social and economic rights, and he would be the one that would be responsible to protecting her. A woman would first be connected to her father, and when she gets married to her husband, and if her husband passes away and she has a son, to her son. But if she doesn't have a father anymore, and if she didn't conceive a son, and her husband passes away, then she's totally and utterly vulnerable, and she has absolutely no rights. So the fact that this woman in this story left the Levite, left her husband, to go to her father, tells us something. Something must have happened for her to make that decision to leave her protection, her security, her situation of privilege, her social standing. Something had to have happened. Verse 3 then tells us about the fact that her husband went to look for her to persuade her to return. Now in the Hebrew we actually read here that he went to go and speak to her heart. It implies that he tenderly wanted to comfort her, to persuade her to come back. It implies he wanted to win her back with kindness. Knowing this, what's your impression of this Levite? What's interesting is that in verse 2, we read it took him 4 months before going in search of her. 4 months is a long time. Why did he take this long? Did it take him this long to notice that she's gone? How does that influence your impression of the Levite? Anyway, the Levite arrives and he then spends 3 days at the father-in-law's home. But what's interesting here is that the narrator never directly talks about the woman. We continually only read about her in the descriptions that she has to the male characters. She's the father's girl, the Levite's wife. But no one actually directly speaks to her or even acknowledges her, and her absence is quite deafening. In the 3 days, the Levite is at his father-in-law's house. And it seems that the conversation that takes place is mostly between the two men. They eat, they drink, they sleep. On the 4th day, the Levite gets up to leave, but the father tries yet again to get him to stay a little longer. He tells them, refresh yourself with something to eat. And so he did. They sat, they ate, they drank. And then the father said, oh, no, it's afternoon now. Now you don't need to stay. You can go tomorrow. And he did. Now, very interestingly, that in the Hebrew, the word that the father replies here or states here to say, refresh yourself, can also be translated, strengthen your heart. Why is this important? Because it ties in with another very interesting element of the story that's baffled the scholars for quite some time. Why is the father so adamant that the Levite must stay another day and another and another? Well, it seems that the father wants to remind his son-in-law about the reason he came to Bethlehem in the first place. He came because he wanted to speak to the woman's heart. He wanted a proper reconciliation to occur between the couple. The father wanted the best for his daughter, and it seems that nowhere the Levite actually even spent time to speak to her. He was speaking to her father all along. They were eating and drinking and sleeping. The word heart is repeated in the Hebrew because the father tries to delay the departure to remind the son-in-law about the real reason he came to Bethlehem. But it falls on deaf ears. And eventually, after staying 4 days, in verse 10, the Levite leaves with his 2 saddled donkeys, his servant, and his wife to return home. And on their journey, the servant says to the Levite, let's stay over in the city of Jebus, which was a Canaanite city. However, the Levite's response is a very emphatic no. Now, why doesn't he want to stay in this town? Because it's the town of aliens, of the other. The Canaanites weren't part of the Jewish people, and staying over in a foreign city where foreign people run the city was not something the Levite was willing to do. By stating this, the Levite is actually portraying to us something that is very true of the people in that time. The Jewish people believed that they were better and more superior to the other nations that surrounded them. He'd only stay over in a Jewish town, and so they pushed through to Gibeah, which fell into the city or the territory of the Benjamin tribe of Israel. How's that character imagination of the Levite coming along in your mind? In the Old Testament, there are very clear hospitality codes. When you arrived in a strange city, you would always go to the square or the market area. The Jews living in the town had the responsibility to look out for travelers, and when they see a traveler, to offer them a place to stay for the night. When you took someone into your home, you took total responsibility for them in every single way. You were responsible to attend to their needs, to give them food, to wash their feet from the day's traveling, to feed their animals, to protect them during the night, to keep them warm. And so the Levite, his wife and his servant, and the two donkeys proceed to sit in the square in the marketplace. But no one offers them a place to stay, which already suggests to us that all is not right in this town. But then an old man comes past the evening, and he strikes up a conversation with the Levite. Interestingly, in this conversation, the Levite says something strange. He tells the old man that he's on his way to the house of the Lord in verse 18. Why would this be important? Perhaps he told the old man this because he desperately wanted a place to stay for that night, and he thought that if the old man knows that he's on his way to the house of the Lord, then surely he would take pity on them more readily, because only those who are upright in character and God-fearing goes to the house of the Lord, right? Another interesting fact in this reading is a slight difference that we find between verse 15 and verse 18. Verse 15, we read that the travelers were waiting in the marketplace because no one wanted to give them a place to stay. But in verse 18, while the Levite speaks to the old man, then suddenly it's all about himself when he says, no one wants to take me in. In this conversation between the Levite and the old man, the woman is silent. And then the Levite does something else that's weird. In Hebrew, there's a word, amar. Women use this word when they want to show their humility towards their protector, normally the male figure in their lives. It was translated as your servant. And in the conversation of the old man, the Levite uses this word in verse 19 when he states, we have the straw, we have the fodder for the donkeys, we have the bread and the wine for ourselves, your servants. He uses this word, which was a female word, a word reserved for women to use when they needed protection, to manipulate and win the old man over to give them shelter for the night. How's that image of the Levite man looking now? The old man takes them in, and he diligently ensures that he follows the hospitality code. He feeds the donkeys, he washes the travelers' feet, he gives them something to eat and something to drink. And it shows us that this old man was in fact a true follower of God. But then something happens. A mob surrounds the house. They want the Levite because they want to rape him. Excuse me. The old man could not allow this to happen because the Levite was under his protection. He tries to reason with the bandits, even calling them my friends, just to try and get them to change their mind. But it's futile. And then he does something strange. He offers his own virgin daughter and the Levite's concubine instead of the Levite. Why would he do this? In ancient cultural logic, the rape of a woman was a lesser offense than the rape of a man. When wars were waged and one group stood victorious, the men in the losing group would be raped to show dominance, to show violence, to take away their dignity, to show them that they mean nothing. in Leviticus, as the Israelites make their way to the promised land, God forbids Israel to ever do this to another tribe when they were victorious. Hence the famous verse that's used quite a lot that says, a man will not lie with a man. It was intended to show that rape is wrong. Rape is violent. Rape is against God. While the old man is still trying to defend the mob or defuse the mob, the conversation is interrupted by the intervention of the Levite. Without saying anything or any form of negotiation, he seizes his wife, pushes the old man out of the door, tosses her outside into the hands of the mob, and then closes the door. This is the first interaction between the Levite and his wife in this story. For someone who wanted to go and talk to her heart, this makes us weep. How's that image of the Levite man coming along now? It seems that the men went back to eating and drinking and eventually went to bed, while the woman, at the hand of the mob, was gang raped, abused, beaten, hurt, mistreated the whole night long until dawn, when they finally let her go. And she managed to get back to the house where the Levite was, fell down at the door, and lay there until daylight. Interestingly, we find a very subtle but important shift in the language used here. Up to this point, the woman was always referred to in terms of the men surrounding her, her father's daughter, the Levite's wife. But here, for the first time, she's simply called the woman. Those who were supposed to have power to protect her, those that she relied on for keeping her rights, failed her. And so she's simply called the woman by the narrator, showing her isolation and her vulnerability. It shows us that the males in her life totally abandoned her. They totally abandoned their responsibility towards her, and the results were catastrophic. There she lay, outside the door, beaten, bleeding, broken. Yet just on the other side of the door, her husband, the Levite, awakes, cared for, safe, and looked after. Refreshed after a good night's rest, goes to the door to carry on his journey like nothing happened. And then suddenly we find the Hebrew word hine. Now hine is a very cool little word in the Hebrew. It means to look or behold. It's used for dramatic effect and to draw attention to something important. It's used to show a different perspective. Almost like when you're watching a movie and you see a scene from outside and then suddenly you see the same scene through one of the characters' perspectives, or one of the characters' eyes. This is exactly what happens here. He opens the door and suddenly we see what he sees. At the threshold lies his wife, her hands on the threshold. We expect some sort of compassion, some sort of love, some sort of kindness. But instead, we find the Levite utterly devoid of compassion and understanding. And all he says is, get up, let's go. These are the first words that he actually speaks to his wife in this story. Again, someone whose initial idea or intention was to go and speak to her heart. Sure. How's that image that you've got in your mind about the Levite looking about now? The woman, however, doesn't answer. And at this point of the story, we can speculate as to why not. Is she alive? Is she unconscious? Is she just too weak? Is she ignoring him? The fact that he speaks to her gives us an idea that maybe she's alive. But our hope is soon shattered. He puts on the donkey and he goes home. And when he arrives home, he cuts her into 12 pieces and then sends a piece of her to every tribe in Israel. Being a narcissist, being an emotional abuser, being a manipulator, being someone that neglects his responsibilities to save himself, as if all of that isn't enough, he also turns into a butcher. He sends her to everyone, and everyone who sees a piece of her doesn't know the full story, and immediately they feel sorry for him on top of it all, as if he tried to protect her. And then the reading ends with the words, "Think about it, consider it, tell us what to do." Perhaps the violence that we see in this world, violence against animals, violence amongst us, gender-based violence, violence against people of a different sexual orientation or race or tribe, violence against children, violent farmer murders, violent mob justice, violent murders that are on the rise, perhaps we also just need to stop. Think about it and consider it. What are we to do? We have a responsibility towards ourselves and towards one another. We have a responsibility to look out for each other, to care about one another, to help each other. We have a responsibility to protect each other. When we take a partner, it is our responsibility to be a good partner to our spouse. It is our responsibility not to hurt them, not to abuse them, not to manipulate them or bully them. It is our responsibility to act in kindness, to act with compassion and understanding, whether you are male or female. We have a responsibility towards those in society that are vulnerable, the stranger, the widow, the widower, the orphan, the children, people who cannot necessarily speak for themselves, people who don't always have the same rights as we do. We are their custodians and the ones that need to make sure that they are safe to look after. We have a responsibility towards the animals in this world. We are not here to exploit them for our own gain, but we are here to look after them. God has placed us in the position of power over the animals, and so it's our jobs to treat them humanely and fairly. We also have a responsibility towards ourselves. When we get into a relationship or a situation where we feel unsafe, or where we feel abused or beaten or threatened or emotionally traumatized, we need to speak out. We need to say something to someone we trust, even if we are petrified and terrified to do so. God doesn't want us to be in a relationship where we are constantly hurt, constantly belittled, constantly beaten, constantly screamed at, constantly scared and terrified for our own safety, constantly told that we are not good enough. Because in God's eyes, you are good enough. You are special. You are so special, in fact, that He died on the cross for you. He created you wonderfully and fearfully. Now, how do we help people in such a bad situation? Well, we listen. That's all we do. We listen, we allow them to speak, we allow them to have a safe space in our presence. We pray for them. And then in time, we start encouraging them. We start building them up in faith until they get to a place and a space where they are ready to leave that situation. It takes a very long time to get to this place. And it's not an easy road. But we have to be each other's safe spaces. We also have to speak out when we hear people say silly things. About 3 weeks ago, I was in a conversation with a group of men where one of the men actually made the comment to say that women aren't human. Because God created Adam, man, and then his wife, implying that his wife is not part of the human race. And I took that person on. How many of us think about all these funny little things and we think it's true, or we hear them and we just think, oh, they're making a joke. We need to speak up when we hear weird things like that being said. Violence has forever been part of our history, and most probably it will remain with us for quite some time to come. But we have to do the little bit we can to stop it in our circles. Now often, when we page through the Old Testament, people often say that the God depicted in the Old Testament is a God that's vengeful, is a God of violence. But it's not true. When we really page through the Old Testament and we read it in detail, then we see how long it really takes God before he gets angry. We see how long it takes him before God finally acts and does something. We see God being very compassionate, being very understanding, and trying everything in his power to keep his people safe and to keep them on the right path. He even takes it so far that he sends his only beloved son to try and stop the violence by making and being the final sacrifice so that we can all have a reconciled relationship to God, so that we can all know how much he loves us. God is not a God of violence. God is a God of love, a God of kindness, a God that cares. He cares about you. He knows what situation you find yourself in. And God wants to wrap you up in his arms, and he wants you to know that he'll do anything and everything to try and help you. So go to God. Go with God. Allow God to help you. Allow God to change your circumstances. We are stronger together, as the Springbok slogan for last year's World Cup stated. We are even more powerful with God on our side. So, to those men out there who do look after their wives and their children, who do protect and love them and care for them and is kind to them, thank you. Thank you for the example that you set. Thank you for raising your little boys as good men. To the women out there that look after their husbands and their children, who protect them and love them and care for them and is always kind to them, thank you for the example that you set. Thank you for raising your daughters to be proper ladies that care. To those of you out there doing everything you can to save animals, thank you for all that you do. Let us stand together. Let us fight violence together with every little small act of kindness that we can do. We can save the world with God's help. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, you are our protector, our armor, our fearless leader. You want the best for us. You want us to be safe, to be secure, to be happy, to be content. But Lord, you know the things that happen in our world that tear us up inside. The things that cause us to live a life of fear, abuse, neglect, and worry. Lord, come and help. Help us to see what to do. Guide our feet, our hands, our hearts, our heads, so that we can bring peace to this world. The peace that you give. The peace and love that transforms, renews, and restores. Lord, this morning we come to pray for all who've experienced violence in their lives in any way or form. We ask, Lord, that you will wrap them in your arms of safety and protection. Watch over them, Lord, if they are still in their violent situations. And bring healing, Lord, if they've managed to break free of the violence that they were exposed to. Lord, help us, your men and women in this world, to do what is right, to do what is fair, to do what is expected of us from you. Grant us the compassion, the understanding, the grace that we need to do your work in our families and our communities. Lord, we come to pray for all those who are ill and suffering in our town, those diagnosed with a terminal illness, those battling with COVID, those burdened with Parkinson's or cancer or Alzheimer's, those facing uncertain times. We pray that you will bring healing and release them from their suffering and pain. We pray, Lord, for all those who are mourning, be their comfort and grant them strength. We pray, Lord, for all our medical workers out there, Protect them as they keep us healthy. Grant them courage for every new day this week. Grant them peace and compassion as they deal with very sick people. Grant them hope and light at the end of this COVID tunnel, and keep them and their families healthy. Holy Spirit, be with us in this new week to come. Guard us, protect us, guide us, and help us to feel your presence every single day. Amen. We now are going to listen to the hymn, Rock of Ages. Ubabalo le nkosi yetu u Yesu Kristu, utando luka tiko, ubutleluana lo moyo uyintwele, malube nani nonke. En nou mag die genade van Christus, die liefde van God, en die gemeenskap van die Heilige Gees met elkeen van julle wees en bly. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and all those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you for joining us this Sunday. We'll see you again next Sunday. Have a blessed day.